All right, let's talk about coffee, because my company, Expert, we brew espresso, like not the kind that you can drink, but the kind that people use. And let me start by sharing what would be the biggest pain point for novice learners, particularly people who are interested in IoT, but you know, they're not too sure where they could start. You know, I'm one of them. I started on IoT very late. I only chanced upon it maybe about 6 months ago. And one of my biggest pain point is there is simply too many things out there. You know, I couldn't make any decision. There are simply too many good stuff, too many companies. Some pretty expensive and too much information. So in other words, we get too much choice to the point that it becomes very, very painful for any beginner to say, you know what, I'm going to go with IBM, you know what, I'm going to go with whatever. You know, there's simply too many choice and it could be very intimidating. Now, you know, when we want to build something, we always turn to the people who are very successful, and I believe Jack Ma said something like, you know, internet business should be as unobvious like turning on a light. You know, it's like electricity is a big concept, but then again, nowadays people don't even think about electricity when they want to use it. So kind of like, you know, IoT is like electricity, is a huge technology, but what people actually want is how I can use it, how I can build something that is easy and basically people could enjoy it. So one of the things that, at least what I envision, would be how to make IoT unobvious, you know. So over the last past few months, we started this Expert as a company since November, and we have been going around to different parts of the ASEAN region, and we have been trying to so-called trial or try to teach people about what is IoT using the boards that we made. And one thing we realized that it is possible where people could learn about IoT without knowing that there's an IoT. For example, in Penang, when we wanted to teach or want to introduce this espresso board, we said that, you know, to program it, you need to learn Arduino. And I tell you, it is a real headache just to kind of like get everybody to be on the same level as what version to use, what dependency you want to install, and stuff like that. And the night before we did the workshop, you know what? We said, let's scrap it. No Arduino for IoT workshop. In this case, we come up with, what if there is a way for people to say, you know, if you do this, if you press that, if you configure that, you can build something. So essentially what happens is that we realize that people actually like they like to see what they have built. They like to enjoy the consequences, but they don't really enjoy the journey. So in this case, we want to make the journey less painful by removing the coding, removing the programming, simply by giving them the tools to build a simple IoT service, such as when I press a button, I get a text notification push to my smartphone. Believe me, to you geeks, it's like, oh, what, is that all? To the 98% of the people out there, is super magical. They are so enchanted. You mean I can do this? The kind of experience is really, really something which tells us that there is something there which we think we can go into. So hence, we actually started to build this product called Espresso Lite. What you see in the market is actually a version 2. And how it comes about is because we actually went to a manufacturer to say, you know what, I want to build the Espresso Lite version 1 or beta version. And to cut the story short, the manufacturer look at the board and say, you know what, would you like to license this board to us? We can redesign the board. And they make so much improvement, it became a totally new board. So it is called the Espresso Lite version 2. Now, as introduced earlier, in fact, this is quite an old slide. We like to tell people that this is an Arduino compatible Wi-Fi enabled development board based on the ESP8266 Wi-Fi chip, right? To date, you don't have to use Arduino to kind of like program it. The Espresso Lite has the library where you can even use like Platform.io. You know, you can, which means you could, it's probably one of the very few boards made in Asia that you could kind of like program it or flash whatever that you write through a universal IDE such as Platform.io. So in fact, later on we found out that people are using this board in ways that we cannot even imagine, and basically this is kind of like standard agnostic, which is fine because after all this is something that it really started out as a fun project, and it's nice that our distributor actually took this board, make it and distribute it in, I think they have told us that is currently being sold in 13 countries in a matter of a few months, you know. So this is really awesome for us. Now the board is nothing magical, this is just a simple breakout board for a module which is made by Expressive System. Expressive makes the ESP8266 chip, and most of the chip is being used by a third-party manufacturer called the AI Thinker, where they make lots of module. You can recognize this module by the ESP01 to ESP, I think now you have 14. These are not made by Expressive, but made by third-party manufacturer. Expressive only make one module, which is the ESP Room 02. And the reason why it is so is because it is the only, or probably the first ESP8266 module, which is FCC, CE and TELEX certified. So in other words, people can buy it without being too jittery about safety and stuff like that. But essentially, it is a breakout board. Nothing very magical about it, and we don't even tell people that we have the best board in the market. But what we can say is that this board is specially rearranged to be able to accommodate a couple of things which I think is cool. For example, remember the days where computers are in giant mainframes, you know? There is no terminal to kind of like see what is happening. People feed punch card comes out, you know, and people have to kind of decipher stuff. Or later on, in 1975, people come up with the first desktop computer called the Altair 8800, which has a row of blinking LEDs and switches, and they call it a computer. Just like MCU or microcontroller, nobody ever thought of an idea of putting a display on it. So we thought it would be cool to just buy one of those cheap OLED that, you know, remnants of the China-made MP3 players, and then kind of like plug it onto on the board and say, what if something comes up? And lo and behold, we get our idea that perhaps this is not the best board, but it is going to be the board that will be able to give users the most information. And one way to differentiate this board is to say, when you buy this board, you are not buying a board, you are buying an experience. Okay. Behind the board, there are souls, you know, that is living. There is stuff that you could use as features. For example, the board, actually, when we sell the board, we say, well, buy the board, don't buy us an L-mine. But just in case you buy the board, you'll be able to use these cool features. There are altogether 6 cool features which eventually, when our cloud is ready, we will be able to provide. Okay, we will be able to create a messaging bus. We can create some kind of rule-based engine like IFTTT. You know, we can do data visualization. We can do a lot of cool stuff like what many companies have done. Now, this is very important to us because a lot of people think that we are a hardware company. Actually, we are not. We actually try to be a cloud/software company because these are things that scale, you know, all right? So, just a side note, we aim for this product to be useful for Arduino. And again, in the same spirit as Arduino, Arduino was never designed for engineers or scientists, mathematicians, technologists. It's designed for artists and designers, right? Likewise, my board is not designed for developers or geeks, hackers. But then again, these are the people I know, I hang out with them all the time. So it's easy. So it's like open chicken rice, I ask you, oh, hey, buy my chicken rice there, you know? It's easier. The real intention of the board is actually to reach out for people who would not normally touch all these electronic stuff because they are scared of it, because it's too intimidating for them. Basically the 98% who would not identify themselves as techie. So this is actually what we hope to do, and we said, well, if you're a beginner, use Arduino IDE. But just in case you are some hardcore street cred hacker, you know, on the street, and Arduino is not your cup of thing, you know, Platform I also can. All right, so basically many flavors for different kind of people. And we thought it would be cool to, let's say, add a bit of a gimmick, you know. And this is a feature, okay? A lot of people say it's a gimmick. Well, put it this way, it's a feature. We are going to give markers, AR markers, and basically an app where users, beginners, can say, hey, I'm going to build something with this AR, and I'm going to show my mommy, I'm going to show my boyfriend, I'm going to show my teacher how cool I am after hanging out with William Hui. All right? So we thought we have this little AR thing, which kind of like makes it a bit enchanting, which kind of like makes it a bit magical, that wow, my handphone is so cool. I can turn a 2D virtual interface, a 2D marker into a 3D virtual interface. So these are just how it looks like, you know, when you could actually use this to control the microcontroller. Alright, so this is a feature, not a gimmick, so you can don't use also, doesn't really matter. Essentially what we have is a type of integrated infrastructure consisting of ABC, app, board, and cloud. Now we are not doing something that new. I must declare that while my company wants to be innovative, do you realize that we are not doing something new? You have seen AR, they've been around for the last 5 years. Everybody also can build the board. You can buy plenty of boards from left and right of Singapore. Okay? There are also many people who have cloud. They are big companies with cloud. So what is so special? Expert. What we are trying to do is to say that, you know what? Sometimes the obvious answer is just right beneath your nose. What people don't realize that all these things can be integrated as one, and it doesn't have to be so-called called A, B, and C. What if the user, when they experience IoT for the first time, they see this and they say, you know what, with this, I can build cool stuff. And because I can build cool stuff, I'll continue to build even more cool stuff. And hopefully, the desire to say, you know what, I want to start a business, or you know what, I want to say, I want to learn more about IoT. I'm now ready to take on Intel. I'm now ready to take on whatever, you know, is there. So we are kind of like the buffer for these big companies to say, we ease your pain. It journeys for IoT need not have to be painful anymore. Okay, give us your pain. So one of the things we hope to do is to say, you know what, we hope to be able to create something that simple enough, kind of like, you know, remember those days where to program a computer, you need to use command line. I mean, we still do, but users of computers have to learn DOS in order to call out a file or run a program. But it is when the shift between DOS, there was a shift when DOS suddenly become Windows, where users find it very easy to navigate, very easy to interact with the environment. That's where, you know, the PC market really took off. And we thought that this would be awesomely cool if we were able to kind of like, in a way, responsible to lead some form of adoption, okay? By introducing something which is less command line, but it's more about how do you bring a good experience for people who, let's say, I want to build something simple. Okay, to impress a person or impress whatever. Okay, so anyway, we have started it, so we got to make it already. And because we are in the maker business, sometimes we have to eat our own dog food, because we tell the people that anybody can make anything as long as you believe that you can learn it. All right, so in this case, we do what we say. No, we preach what we don't know. We do what we preach. Done. Done already. So next is, of course, to say, you know what, can we involve more people to be part of this? Now, this project is not entirely so-called my own brainchild or whatever. I'm a dreamer. My job is to dream. But behind this group is actually a work contribution from people from different countries. My co-founder is, his name is Jimmy, he is from Thailand. The board is actually made by crazy people in Penang. Okay, there's a factory that's crazy enough to build this, and they were so excited to building it. All right, I just met someone from Indonesia who is superly big fan of this. Okay, over time, I was hoping that perhaps, you know, this could be something that could be owned, not just by my company, but it could be owned by people around here. You know, something that you could work on. I tell you, it's not really the best. But then again, sometimes just like your own house, it may not be the best house, you know, like some guy live in a big bungalow and this guy has a swimming pool, but it's still your home. In this case, this is what we have, and we hope that you would come and like help us to make it better. All right, I still have a lot of time, am I? Do I? All right, I have so much time. All right, ask me anything. Closed door, among geeks, you ask me anything. Universally, it is $9.95 USD. Okay, because we peg our price against Adafruit's Huzza. Yes. Do I have some today? I wish I have some, but I left it at IoT Asia. Yeah, I just got back from IoT Asia. Any question? Question? No?
Hey.
Yeah.
Is it one control chip that we're using? Is it ESP into
16? Yes, that's right. So this one, like today during IoT Asia, I've been explaining like Expressi system really had a foresight of building a Wi-Fi chip on top of a 32-bit RISC chip, you know, which means it's a very powerful Wi-Fi chip, and I think it has enough power that the processor can kind of like be turned into a microcontroller. So while we can do microcontroller functions, it was never designed to be a microcontroller. It's just that we are kind of like hacking it, you know. So it is really a very powerful Wi-Fi chip for the cost that you pay. I think Minister mentioned that it is the chip that is made less than, the cost of making is less than a dollar. So it is something which is quite amazing. And not many people know, but the founder of that company, although the company is in China, the founder of the company is a Singaporean. So it has a bit of a Singapore DNA. And so it carries the spirit of the Singapore diaspora.
Quite a lot of features in there for the cloud capability and how interoperable with this with other hardware or other APIs, for example, that are out there?
If you unpack it, it is no different from any chip that you buy. You know, it is the same. It's in other words, it is standard agnostic. It is IDE agnostic, which means that you can flash it with anything. This thing talks to any cloud. And basically, it is not like it has to work only with expert library or you know. So it is an ESP8266 that we kind of like at a factory make it kind of like talk to our cloud. And then in this case, something for the user. So if the user don't want it, they want to, you know, they want to use this feature. Fine. They can always use other things. It's their choice. So. It's the market, you know, so it's fine. Yes?
So, go back to the picture of the
professor, right?
Sure. And that's your current design. Like, has it changed? I'm just wondering, because the idea seems to be working with the direction.
Why is it at the perpendicular, the antenna perpendicular and not It's actually functionality. Because we want to mount something on the top, so we need to free the top. So, but it's fine. It works. It works.
So, no.
Nothing was done. We just put like that, you know. So because it's convenient, you know. We did not do any testing, you know. Unlike boards where you go through some kind of, don't know how many hours of tests. No, this thing no testing. The testing costs money. We are bootstrapping. Oh, by the way, we are raising funds. It would be nice if everybody get a board, you know. So far 12 gigs is selling, you know. And I believe 12 gigs is offering, it's supposed to be $14. 12 gigs may sometimes offer this at $12 from time to time. And I think so. if 12 of you buy immediately, it's $12, right? You can find 12 gigs is $12. All right. Yes. What do they create now? Offhand, unless they post on Facebook, I really do not know. But I know already some people have been building shields on top of this. That means they think that this is not good enough, so they are making additional add-on bots. Like they want to build a small little relay plug-in, you know, so that they can use it to control whatever. So I know of some guy who runs a bee farm. He bought those to, I don't know what to do with bees, you know. He wants to teach bees. Now, basically, he wants to optimize the production of honey. And this is a project in Malaysia. So really, the sky is the limit. So I think I'm hanging around here. So if you have any question, you can catch me later. So thank you very much. And enjoy yourself tonight.